Corbett Harrison, coming to you from the upstairs office here at the Harrison household. Welcome. Today we're going to talk a little bit about interactive notebooks and the three big ideals I push behind them, which is I want them as places where my students will record new content and ideas. I want them to personally process that information, and then I want them to prepare to present it to others. That's the point of this video today. Some of you are in my online class where your final product is to create interactive notebook pages, and this video is kind of a tutorial on the steps you'll go through as well as the thinking process. So if you need to watch this more than once to make sure you're making your interactive notebook pages correctly, I invite you to do so. So let me minimize my face here. That's not what you need to see. Put myself right on the picture of the book by Diana Zeik that probably started the whole interactive notebook concept for me, her Foldables book. She has a lot of great books, but her Foldables book really struck me as a great concept for building a notebook that the students would interact and care about. I ended up using probably 5 or 6 of the Foldables, and then I started creating my own, and I think that's the ideal that you want to have happen if you're going to use Foldables. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment, but let me tell you about the 2 interactive notebooks that happen in my classroom, both kept in composition books. I find those stay together a little bit better. Our first one is called a writer's notebook, and this is probably more useful in a language arts kind of classroom. I don't think my students have enough time to think for themselves, and so every day in my classroom they have 10 minutes to write in something we call our writer's notebook. It allows them for 10 minutes just to reflect, to be themselves. An athlete needs to practice in order to be a better athlete. A writer needs to write daily in order to be a better writer, and here's their chance to really build original thinking. That's what a writer's notebook is. The thing about the topics is the students choose them, or they learn to come up with their own topics on their own. It takes them a while to get there, but topics aren't necessarily content-based, and then students are always encouraged to try new formats. Don't just always write a block paragraph for me. Try some different things. Make your notebook fun to flip through so you look back and think at your own thinking. That's one type of notebook. The other type of notebook is our interactive notebooks, or our IMBs, as we like to call them. Interactive notebooks are different because we use them in my class mostly with nonfiction. I have had them create pages based on literature before, but I find they're most helpful when we're in our nonfiction mode. And so when we're learning a new piece of content, and we don't do this with every piece of content, just the ones that, you know, you need to really have them process deeply. There is certainly a lot of content we need to give coverage to, but then if it's content you want to go deep with, an interactive notebook page is an interesting strategy to put in front of them. What students do is they record the content, or at least the content that they consider to be the most important for the whatever it is they're working on, and then they have to reflect on it in a personal or a unique way. That's the big idea here. And then students are always, just like with writer's notebooks, they're always encouraged to try different formats and add an element of interactivity when you present this page to someone else, which is the big idea. You get to be teacher with the presentation of information that you've created. What can you do to have the audience who's watching you present this interact with it? There are great ways, and that really is something that appeals strong to your advanced learners. They really like to do that, and then they spread that idea among all of your learners. And so I'm big into teacher models. Here is a teacher model. This one is based on a book called It's Disgusting and We Ate It, and it's history told through gross things that people have eaten. And this is a page that I created, and on this page there are content notes. They're inside the dialogue bubbles. When I learned interesting facts, I put them inside dialogue bubbles. What I actually did here was I reflected on them personally by giving voice to them from people from history, but I put those notes actually in the quotes with the place where I was reflecting. I chose to do 5 dialogue bubbles here. So that's how I reflected. I prepare to present this to, as a teacher, to someone else. Here's what I thought about this content. What did you think about this content? Or here's the content I made a page on. You may have made one on totally different page. We teach each other, and we look at each other's differences and similarities on our pages. And then an advanced challenge that I always give my my advanced students is add an interactive element. Don't let them be a passive audience member when you're presenting this to them. have them actively participate in some way that you have strategically planned. And like I said, it catches on very nicely. And so these are the two interactive notebooks that we have in my classroom. And again, this video is about the second type. Here's, I often look at what other teachers sell and put up there, and I don't want to complain about it. I just look at something like this. I like the idea. It's an interactive page. The students can take those post-its off, write new things on them, try them in different ways. They're building main ideas here and supporting ideas. And I like that concept here, but I just think the teacher has written way too many words on this page. I think in an ideal interactive notebook, the students' words are the ones that are most represented on the page. And this is a great idea, but I wouldn't call this an interactive notebook page unless the student was more in charge of the creation. Now here's one where you see a little writing on the side. You kind of hope this teacher didn't spend all their time coloring, because that's not a good form of curriculum. I'm hoping that if you flipped that up, you'd see a whole lot of other ways that the student was reflecting on those notes. It's a picture on the internet. I can't do that, but when I look at pages like this, that's what I'm always thinking. Where's the student writing? Where's the student element? Now, here's one I actually like a lot, because it folds up in itself. It's got basic notes, four types of triangles. You fold that up, you have all this white space around that page left, and that's the perfect opportunity to reflect personally on the topic, to use that space. And so I look at this and I say, oh, well, what would I do? I've just learned facts about four types of triangles, and I want to reflect personally on them. Well, there's lots of different ways that you can do that. One way I was thinking was, maybe you could create an advertisement using the rest of the page, and your job is to sell the one triangle that you've decided is probably the most useful triangle of the four triangles here. That's a way to reflect personally. You've turned it into something that it's not, but you've reflected on the content personally and made something new that didn't exist before. You might even go with an extra challenge of that. I always have an extra challenge for the students who finish early. Good, now your job is to make an advertisement for the least useful triangle on this page, and you better use your skills of persuasion and sell it just as well. That's a great activity for students. Now here's one for history, and I wanted to just pull off some things. So in that top left section with the red ink, there's some notes they'll take here on Pearl Harbor. You can set up content pages these ways, but I looked at here's the questions they got asked. Who attacked Pearl Harbor and why, and what was the result? Here are the questions that they typed up. These questions are pushing towards cause and effect. I don't know if they're successfully getting there with these as models for examples, but I look at this and I say, you know what, I could think of a much more interesting way to maybe get students to think about those two questions differently. And so maybe find four reasons Japan attacked Pearl Harbor and then rate their importance from the Japanese point of view as you understand it. That's taking facts and preparing to present it in a way that's a personal reflection upon them. You might also say, and who else supported the attack? You got more swipe space on the page. Find others who may have supported the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor and get their perspectives, so that rather than just answering some review questions, you're really putting some personal reflection into it. Good interactive pages. Now here are the idea of foldables, that facts can go on them. My hope is, with a lot of these, I see them typed. My hope is that there's a little typing that you can do, and then the students can do a little bit of writing. I think they need to write to show that they're understanding. But then you ask yourself, what can I do to then personally reflect on this content that's captured in these foldables? And I think it's just really important to develop a personal toolbox of ways to challenge students to reflect personally. There's a great book, 51 Wacky Research Reports. I'm sure some of you know it. And one idea in that book on page 152 is recall the idea, or explain the idea back to me, but do it in the form of a recipe. Here are my ingredients. Here's how I mix them together. That takes a different kind of thinking, and a good challenge kind of thinking. Maybe you can create a fake news story about the content. In this book, he does it as a tabloid news story, but maybe it could become a serious news story too. Page 84 of the book, you can find that idea. My students like to create trading cards, like baseball cards, like Pokemon cards. They have stats on the back. What sort of trading card with stats? That's a great thing to put in an interactive notebook, where it shows that you're personally reflecting on the information that you learned by capturing it in stats. And then finally, write an advice column. It's on page 92, like from the newspaper, Dear Abby style. And then I also launched the idea, what if there was a horoscope that you could do for all the generals of the Civil War, for example? That's not in the book, but the ideas of this book, they inspire new ideas. It's not hard once you start playing with ideas to inspire students to think creatively or uniquely in ways that they could reflect. That's a common theme in my classroom. I want them to build their own ideas, but I also want them to find interesting ways for them to reflect on those ideas. And over time, you know, I keep a running list in the classroom of formats that we can imitate. And what's nice is as we talk about each of them, we also talk about how could we take a dialogue bubble assignment where three or four people have dialogue bubbles, and that's how you're explaining your thinking or the content. How could you have someone else interact with that? And so, you know, you could start suggesting things like, well, if you have four dialogue bubbles, five dialogue bubbles, whose voice is the loudest? Whose voice is the weakest? All right. Here are some ways that once you create a format to count as your personal reflection on the page, here are some interactive ways that you can have people respond to it. And so let me just show you those through examples. So here's my five dialogue page about the disgusting things people ate from history, and whose voice is the most convincing. So that's what I would have the person who I am teaching my page to have to answer at the end of this. That's an interactive element. I actually did it on this page with those post-its, but that's an easy element to add that's interactive. Have them pay attention for a purpose. Here's a book of important passages. Important passages, if you don't know or happen to care, the important book is a book of small passages, and they are all written in the exact same format. You teach students to imitate that format, and you can end up with important passages about any topic. And so have students create these in their interactive notebooks, and then the interactive thing could be as simple as, so which sentence in all of my passages do you think has the best detail in it? That's a way to have the students interact and make sure they're responding to each other's content. Here's a crazy newscast, which was partially inspired by the Wacky Research book, but also inspired by this book, Tabubu, which is a charming little picture book that's out of print. The little boy gets his toe caught in the spigot, and it gets worse, and they just can't get him out. Well, the funny part of the book is the older sister is standing on the front lawn reporting on the whole incident like she's practicing to be a news reporter, and so that's the voice of the book. And I create a page and show my students how I created this page, and oh my gosh, they start imitating me. They start popping up. Here's one of my students' newscast of the Christmas night during World War II when both sides played soccer together. There's a newscast based on that. And here the student could simply say, read my script and help me find my reporter's voice. That's an interactive element to this page. And so what we'll be doing in this class is you'll be creating interactive notebook pages. Interactive notebook pages have you record new ideas, process that information in a personal way, and then prepare to present it to others, possibly with that piece of interactivity if you're one of my advanced students. But that's where we're going. And for your final project in my online classes, you will create seven pages. Three of them will be on topics that we do as a class, and then four of them will be on topics that through your research, you will discover topics that you want to explore on your own and create your own interactive pages for. Your interactive pages like mine need to have content notes in the form of notes in the form of content. You need to reflect on that content somehow personally on the page, and I'm going to say a two-page spread is what we typically shoot for, and you have to prepare to present that page as a teacher and plan an interactive element to it. I'm going to show you just one more quick model. Here is a page I was creating on Teddy Roosevelt's leadership style, and so here you see the book that I used and you see the notes that I typed up. You're not required to type notes. Sometimes I do it just because it helps me transport them around. Here is the draft I created. The theme I challenged myself with this page was puzzle, and so the idea of a crossword puzzle with some clues came to me, and that also led me to how I can make this page interactive. All right, so I can share these clues and see if they can get them. And so that's my draft, and then my draft became a final draft. A word about drafts, because I'm sure I'll be asked. I do keep another notebook with my drafts in it, just because I like my pages together. Your drafts don't have to go in another notebook or in your notebook. Only your final pages need to really go in the interactive notebook that you're setting up. And so that's the concept of an interactive notebook. Thank you for joining us today. I look forward to seeing, if you're taking my class, the seven pages that you'll create as your final project. And again, remember, this video exists so that you can go back and look at these criteria and say, am I going through the process right or am I not? So thanks for joining us today from Harrison Household. Look forward to seeing the products and ideas that you create in your own interactive notebooks. Have a great day, everybody. Bye.